Tonight's Teardown is assisted by Grandpa's Sweater Oatmeal Stout from Barnhammer Brewing in Winnipeg. They don't have any tasting notes on the can, but that doesn't bother me because I've had this one many times before. It's got a nice oatmeal finish to it. It's nice and malty. It's a little bit hoppy, but not too much. Just right there in my wheelhouse. So today, I'm taking a look at this piece of equipment that I picked up at a thrift store for super cheap a few weeks ago, as is not tested cell phone booster kit for $5. I'm going to start with a disclaimer right now. When I was working as a field tech for a cellular company for a good deal of my working life, I hated these things. I absolutely hate them. My coworkers hate them. Not because they are some sort of an evil technology. It's just that they are so often misused and they cause so much trouble to the cellular network when they're not properly installed and not properly used, which happens most of the time. So the purpose of these things is to basically install at your house, or with this particular one, it's intended to be installed in a vehicle. And it has an outdoor antenna and it has an indoor antenna. The outdoor antenna connects to the cellular base station and the indoor antenna connects to your phone. And that outdoor antenna theoretically is sitting at a higher level and with less obstructions, so it can pick up a decent signal from the cell tower. And then, I'll have to look at that in a second. And then it will amplify the signal to your phone and basically make it as if you've got an outdoor elevated amplified antenna on your phone. So if you're in weak areas or something like that, it should theoretically help boost the signal up for you. In the case of this one, it claims to have 25 dB of amplification on the 800 megahertz cellular band and the 1900 megahertz cellular band, but only those two bands, which is not a big deal. They're still in use. They're not the only channels in use. They're the oldest ones, and they're probably the most congested, but they definitely exist. This thing claims to be able to work with CDMA, GSM, Edge, and AMPS, which is the old analog system that doesn't exist anymore. And there's no reason it couldn't work with more modern technologies as well, because this thing is just a raw RF amplifier. It's not doing any decoding or anything else. And those channels are still in use today. Here's the GSM frequencies that exist or ever existed. And in North America, we use the 850 and the 1900. And you can see the uplink frequency. So from your mobile to the base station, for 850 was between 824.2 and 848.8. And the downlink from the base station, the tower, to your mobile device, 869.2, 93.8. And similarly, here's the 1900 that this thing works with. There's the uplink and there's the downlink. If we go to UMTS, again, there's those same 1900 frequencies, uplink and downlink, the same pairing. And 850, again, the same and the same down there. LTE, there's your 1900, and again, the same frequencies. And 850 is there with the same frequencies. And 5G, aka new radio, or NR. It can operate on the same frequencies again. There's the 1900s and there's the 850. So what I'm expecting to find inside this thing is a couple of RF filters, bandpass filters for those two frequency bands, combiners to combine the various different frequencies onto single antenna ports, and then a whole bunch of amplification in the middle of it. Wow, that's really well strapped into there. Okay. So this document that was in the manual is the original purchase bill for the customer copy of it. This cost Randy $249 when he bought it back in 2012. Wow. And because this one is designed to run on 12 volts and it comes with lighter plugs, this one is designed to be operated in a vehicle like a mobile home, a motorhome, or probably a semi. So part of my hatred for these things, and the thing that causes so much trouble in the cellular network, is how they operate. Basically, they are an on-channel RF booster. So you've got the indoor antenna and the outdoor antenna. Each of them are receiving and transmitting the same frequencies. It's receiving the downlink from the cell tower. It's amplifying it, and it is sending that to the phone, and then it is receiving from the phone, amplifying that, and sending it out the antenna back to the base station. If those two antennas can see each other's signal, this will be amplifying the output of one antenna and transmitting it and being received by the other antenna and back and forth. And that is a feedback loop. That is the same thing that happens when you point a microphone at a speaker, except for in the RF world. And when that happens, it is sending out that squeal, that single frequency at the amplified level back to the base station. The base station is receiving that, and it's not expecting that kind of signal. So what the base stations are designed to do when they receive a signal they don't expect is to attenuate the receive level at the base station for every single cell phone, every single user that is trying to use that base station. Can you see why the base station attenuating its receive signal for everybody would be a bad thing? That's why we hate these things, because it deafens the system and other users cannot have access to the system. It basically fixes a problem for one guy and screws it up for everybody else. Now, this particular one, being designed to operate in a vehicle, means that it's mobile. So when you're trying to track down the offending piece of equipment that's interfering with your network, the bloody thing keeps moving. They are so hard to track down, and they cause problems all over the network. Such a problem. And yes, okay, if they are properly installed, they should work fine, and they shouldn't do that. These things are installed by users, by non-technical people, by people that don't understand RF. They're seldom installed properly. Okay, I'm going to stop ranting now. Let's see what else is in here. Oh, you have a piece of rubber hose. Ah. He probably put that over the edge of his window to put the cable through outside so it didn't get cut. Okay, don't need that.
We have
an AC to DC power pack. Universal AC input voltage, 12 volt, 1.5 amp output. And then in here we have some little adhesive Velcro stickers. Okay, so this one didn't have its outdoor antenna with it, which is fine because I wasn't planning on connecting it anyway. The indoor antenna, however, with this unit comes with this thing, which has Velcro on it, and it is just a small little antenna that you Velcro to the back of your phone. So this particular one, the indoor antenna, is not going to be broadcasting over a huge area, which is very nice compared to a lot of these kind of things that I've seen. So that is probably saving this particular guy, what was his name, Randy, that bought this thing, from upsetting a lot of people around him as he's driving around. So in the back of it, we find a bunch of screws, one of which appears to be hiding underneath us there. Yep. Okay, and of course, we also have the guy's name on the back of it, which I have anonymized with the handyman's secret weapon. I'll just pop these screws out and pry this thing open and see what's inside it. Okay, that pops open really easily. I appreciate that. What kind of magical mysteries do we have in here? It's Wilson Electronics is the manufacturer. This is a 2010 design. There's the circuit board number and everything else. So we have a main chip there, a few smaller chips, an RF transistor there. What is this big TO240 in the corner? Oh, hello. That is a 5-volt regulator. There's somebody familiar. We have 12 volts coming in there, electrolytic, a bunch of smaller capacitors there, DS1, which is likely going to be a diode, an LED, and a resistor for it. Let's start over with the indoor antenna over here. We have FL1, FL2, FL3, FL4, which are all going to be filtering devices. Potentiometer, another filter there. An unpopulated chip, interesting. And then a bunch of passives. Moving along, we have another potentiometer there. Here is U3. That type of a package is typically going to be an RF transistor, an RF amplifier, something like that. after him, 81 attenuator, maybe. Interesting. Just more passives and stuff. Oh, inductor. Another transistor. Another filter. And then out to the outdoor antenna. Well, out or in, right? These antennas are both bidirectional. So the different filters are going to be, as I said, separating the 1900 frequencies and 850 frequencies and splitting them into their uplink and downlink band. So you'll essentially have four RF paths, two going in that direction and two going in that direction at the different frequencies. I'm assuming this guy is just controlling the gain and whatnot of thing. As I said, this doesn't demodulate the signals. It doesn't break them down at all. This is strictly a raw RF amplifier. That's all it's doing in the two different directions. So this guy could probably be measuring amplitudes and stuff and adjusting gains and whatnot. That's my best guess as to what's going on inside there. Let's take a look at the other side of the board and see what's on there, because I only see one amplification stage unless it's happening in that chip, and I doubt it. So far, it's been fairly easy to get all the screws out of. However, to get the connectors out to release the board, I have to unsolder the connectors from the board and pull them out like that, which goes surprisingly easily. This thing feels like it was designed to be taken apart and repaired. Wow, there is literally nothing on the other side of this board. So I have to assume that that chip is doing all of the magic. That doesn't seem like an amplifier to me. It should be bigger, I would think, but let's see if we can find this guy and find out. RF3108. Okay, well, I guess it is actually an amplifier. All right. I guess that makes a certain amount of sense, since it's the biggest thing on the board. It's going to be doing most of the work, and it did have a bit of heatsink goop under it. And it looks like it is designed exactly for this purpose. Used as a final RF amplifier in GSM and PCS band cellular equipment for 800 meg and 1900 meg. Cool. Oh, wow, yeah, the datasheet has a whole bunch of theory of operation stuff. If you want to read it, go for it. As I said, the part number is RF3108, and it is an easy-to-find datasheet. So I looked around for the part numbers on some of these other devices, and that is literally the only one that I could find. This filter and this filter are the same part number. This filter and this filter are the same part number. So I'm going to assume that they are four different bands. The larger one, the physically larger one, is probably for the 850 band, and the physically smaller one probably for the 1900 band. Could be wrong, but without being able to find the data sheets, it's so hard to tell. And that transistor I came up blank on as well. That's one of those, you know, two-digit surface mount transistor numbers that it's just so hard to find those. But there aren't any real surprises in this thing other than how basic a device it is, how little there is inside it for what it's doing. That still doesn't change my disdain for this general class of device, though. They have caused me so much trouble over the decades that I was working as a field tech. If you have a cellular booster, if you think you need one, please have it installed properly by someone who knows what they're doing. Make sure that the indoor antenna and the outdoor antenna are as far physically away as possible from each other, that they have as many walls and other impediments like that in between them as possible, and that the outdoor antenna is a directional antenna that's pointed towards the cell tower and pointed away from where your indoor antenna is. If you do it wrong, you will get a knock on your door eventually from a really grumpy, really tired cell company employee asking you to fix your shit, or from a government inspector ordering you to shut it down immediately. These things, as I said, they can cause so many problems to the cellular network if they're not set up and installed properly. And for my former co-workers, I am not going to reassemble this thing. It is going to be destroyed so that nobody can ever use this particular one again. You're welcome. Everyone else, thanks for watching. Questions or comments down below. I'll talk to you later.